Hi, this is Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting Section 3.4 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This section focuses on pharmacology and specifically on use of anticoagulation. Pharmacology is the third of the 14 steps of percutaneous coronary intervention, and anticoagulation is one of the seven major categories of medications that are used during cardiac catheterization and percutaneous coronary intervention. The indication of anticoagulation is to prevent thrombus formation, both on the various equipment used during the procedure, but also within the coronary and the peripheral circulation. For example, when radial access is used, administration of anticoagulation reduces the risk of radial artery occlusion. This is an example of what we're trying to avoid in the coronary circulation. This patient underwent PCI of an LAD CTO complicated by perforation, requiring implantation of a covered stent. During the procedure, no more heparin was given, and the ACD decreased to 227, at which point the patient developed a thrombus in the proximal to mid LAD. Avoiding thrombus formation, both within the coronary artery and elsewhere, is the major goal of anticoagulation. In nearly all cases currently, the anticoagulant of choice is unfractionated heparin, the reason being low cost as well as effectiveness, as well as the presence of a reversal agent. Unfractionated heparin is a sulfated polysaccharide that is usually made out of porcine intestinal mucosa. In contrast to bivalirudin that will be discussed subsequently, unfractionated heparin requires antithrombin. It is an indirect anticoagulant. It forms a complex with antithrombin, and this complex then exerts its effect on thrombin as well as factor 10A and other coagulation factors. Heparin does not require adjustment for renal insufficiency and has a half-life that depends on the dose given. For lower doses, the half-life is shorter, whereas for higher doses, the half-life is longer. And the reason being the attachment of heparin to endothelial cells. With higher doses, there is saturation of endothelial cells, and therefore the unfractionated heparin lasts longer. The effect of heparin depends on other heparin binding proteins as well, because heparin binds not only to antithrombin, but on other proteins, and in patients who have high levels of such heparin binding proteins, the anticoagulant effect of unfractionated heparin may be lower, requiring higher doses. The usual dose of unfractionated heparin for percutaneous coronary intervention is 70 to 100 units per kilogram in patients who do not receive intravenous antiplatelet agents. If glycoprotein to B3 inhibitors or cangrelor are used, then the dose is lower at 50 to 70 units per kilogram. Given the unpredictable effect, use of heparin requires careful monitoring, which is done measuring the ACT or activated clotting time. The goal ACT is between 300 and 350 seconds if no IV antiplatelet agents are used, and it's lower at 200 to 250 seconds in patients who do receive 2B3 inhibitors or cangrelor. In some cases, for example, retrograde CTO intervention, more intensive anticoagulation is desired to avoid donor vessel thrombosis with ACT levels more than 350 seconds. A unique advantage of heparin is the presence of a reversal agent, which is protamine. Protamine is given at a dose of 1 to 1.5 milligrams for 100 units of unfractionated heparin, up to 50 milligrams, and does carry a risk of allergic reaction, which is more likely to occur in patients who have received in the past NPH insulin, have this allergy, have undergone vasectomy, have severe LV dysfunction and abnormal pulmonary hemodynamics. One of the potential adverse events is systemic hypotension with pulmonary hypertension that can be life-threatening and can be treated with methylene blue. A key to minimize the risk of adverse reactions with protamine is to give it slowly at 5 milligrams per minute. Another anticoagulant that can be used for percutaneous coronary intervention is bivalirudin. Bivalirudin is a direct factor 10A inhibitor in contrast to unfractionated heparin, that is an indirect inhibitor. Bivalirudin is currently mainly used in patients who have heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. there is no significant difference in bleeding risk with bivalirudin versus unfractionated heparin, provided that there is no concomitant to B3A inhibitor usage. Bivalirudin, in contrast to heparin, requires both a bolus and an infusion, and the dose needs to be adjusted for renal failure. Monitoring is done also with measuring ACT, and there is no reversal agent. However, the half-life is 25 minutes. What are the main complications of anticoagulation? As expected, the number one is bleeding. This is more likely to occur with excessive anticoagulation, hypertension, vascular access complications, or other injury. The best way to prevent it is by accurate dosage of the anticoagulant and close ACT monitoring, which is typically happening every 20 to 30 minutes during the procedure. And for treatment, there are local measures to control the bleeding. If the patient is anticoagulated with unfractionated heparin, protamine can be given for reversal. Another potential risk is from thrombosis, which can happen due to under anticoagulation from inadequate dosing. Another potential reason might be malfunction of the intravenous line that results in non-optimal administration of the anticoagulant in the systemic circulation. Heparin-induced thrombocytopenia is another potential reason. And as discussed before, there is a variable response to unfractionated heparin. Therefore, close monitoring of the ACT is critical, as is accurate dosing. The treatment of intracoronary thrombus is discussed in detail in chapter 20 and in a separate video. Specifically for heparin, there is the risk of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. There are two types. Type 1 is a benign that does not cause significant clinical consequences. However, type 2 is a severe reaction, usually happens a few days after unfractionated heparin administration, and can have life-threatening consequences with both arterial as well as venous thrombosis. If the patient is known to have HIT, then bivalirudin should be used instead of heparin for the procedure. So in summary, anticoagulation is a critical class of medications for cardiac catheterization and percutaneous coronary intervention. Currently, unfractionated heparin is the anticoagulant of choice for essentially all patients, except for those who have heparin-induced thrombocytopenia for whom bivalirudin is used. It is critical to carefully monitor the dosage and the anticoagulant effect of heparin by measuring activated clotting time every 20 to 30 minutes and supplementing with additional heparin doses if needed. Thank you.